So here's the production of a BruxZir crown start to finish. This is a dentist who sent us a polyvinyl siloxane impression. So we poured it up in stone. There's the stone model right there of the prep arch. And as you can see, this is being put into a three-shape scanner. We want to get this into the digital environment as quickly as possible because everything works better for us in the digital environment. It's so much more consistent. If the dentist had sent a digital impression, then we would start right from that. But we had a conventional impression, so there's no really good impression scanners out there on the market, so we still have to pour the model in stone, and now we're going to scan it and bring it into the digital environment. So it's going to look like the dentist took a digital impression in the mouth. It's just that we had to do it ourselves, and it's not quite as accurate as if the dentist did it in the mouth, to be honest, because there's distortions in polyvinyl and dental stone. There's the articulated model. So now we're going to be able to scan that from the side, and now we can see exactly how much reduction we have between that prep tooth and the opposing tooth. No more guessing on our part, and this is one of the big benefits for dentists who have digital impression scanners, is that they can see the reduction actually in the mouth. We're going to mark the margin here and move it around and try to be true to it. As long as the dentist has left us enough room, which this dentist really did, you can see we've got an ideal anatomical pattern that it's going to propose for that particular crown. If there's not enough room, then it has to start making changes. We can make little changes here per the doctor's request if we need to on the contacts, but most of the time with us designing it the same way every time, most doctors don't have us make many changes. You can see that the different crown designs here are all being nested. These are all going to be A2 crowns, for example, and so unlike Emax, which is milled in a small block, BruxZir crowns are milled from a big white hockey puck, so we do a bunch of crowns at the same time. So here's that one. You can see there's a barcode that has to be matched up. That's the enlargement factor, because believe it or not, you know, one of the things that we hear about these crowns is that, oh, they fit better than any crown I've had before from you guys. The amazing thing is, you can see here, they're milled roughly 21-22% bigger than the final crown's going to be. And that's what the enlargement factor refers to. So there's an exact factor for each block based on the weight and density of the zirconia. Once that's been measured, that's what that barcode tells the milling machine, so it knows exactly how much bigger to make those crowns. You can see they look huge. They look like veterinary crowns. They don't look like human crowns, and they're going to shrink while they're in the oven, and amazingly, they're going to end up fitting just fine when you go to try them in the mouth. So they're cut, sprues are removed, they're cut out of the disc, and they're put on those little alumina oxide balls that you can see there, because these are going to shrink roughly 21% while they're in the oven for 9 hours. We need those little ball bearings to help so that when the crown actually shrinks, there's no contact between the tray and the crown, or else it would distort the shape of it. So this way, as the crowns shrink during the 9 hours center, those ball bearings roll underneath the crown. So the crown ends up being exactly the same shape. It just shrinks by whatever, 21 to 22% based on the exact enlargement factor for that particular block. Once it comes out, we do a little sandblasting to get it all cleaned up, and now we're going to put some color on it. So this is some staining that's being done to match whatever color the dentist has requested. The block started off as an A2, but there's still a degree of characterization that needs to be done. Typically, we're going to have some translucency by the cusp tips, and we're going to have some increased chroma in the gingival third. Here we're spraying the glaze on. This is what Rella and Gordon Christensen aren't huge fans of, because that glaze we put on there that makes it look pretty when it comes out of the oven, that glaze actually is rougher, has bigger particle size, and is rougher than the zirconia oxide underneath it. And so really the only reason that a BruxZir crown initially wears opposing enamel is because of that glaze on the outside. And as a result, Rella has asked us, is there any way you guys can just polish the outside of those crowns? So for any doctor who asks for it, we do just polish the outside of the crown without any glaze. It's not as pretty, but it doesn't wear the opposing at all without the glaze. As part of our quality control, we use the Vita Easy Shade to verify that it is in fact an A2 crown before we send it out to the doctor. Everybody sees color a little bit different, and that's why we like this computer device to make sure that we're sending out the crown in the exact same shade that the doctor requested.